fast and still. Look at the ceiling.
Ready for x-ray.
Jared, you awake there?
He's having unusual periods where he's stopping breathing.
Now, get me the oxygen now, because it's set to 86. Jared! Jared!
He's behaving like he has a severe brain injury.
He's not breathing, he's not attending to me, he doesn't wake up and he quickly desaturates.
Would you rescue me? What about myself? When I need your love, if I need your help, would you rescue me? Would you rescue me? But I start to wonder if I'm slipping under. Oh, would you rescue me? Would you give my
very worried for you, my friend.
The bone's being smashed to bits.
Whoa! Would you
rescue me? He's actually stopped breathing.
Without intervention, he's quite likely to die.
Better?
Emergency doctor Jonathan Papson is starting his shift already under pressure.
Car breaks down, had to go and rescue her.
In the fuss of that, I've left my badge in the car.
Can't get in the door, can't get into any secure spot. That's a bit tricky, isn't it?
Security, give me a car. Look, it's a bit frustrating. But no matter how old your kids get, you never stop being a parent.
Right?
That's what dads are there for.
This is Royal Melbourne Hospital. You are clear to land.
An air ambulance is heading to the Royal Melbourne, coming in from country Victoria.
We've had word a gentleman has crashed his car driving high speed and the car's rolled over several times into a paddock. So many possibilities for injuries from that kind of mechanism.
Dr. Jonathan takes the case and will lead the trauma team.
The helicopter's on the pad. They're about to arrive.
The patient is 72-year-old James, known as Jim.
Yeah, we're good.
He was driving his ute in a 100K zone when it left the road, rolled several times and landed in a paddock.
How you doing there, Jim?
Good.
When the accident happened, the retired draftsman was on his way to the local shop to buy food for his dog.
There's a lot of question marks on this bit of paper, which is always concerning.
At that speed, with that kind of force, there are many possible injuries someone could have. Now, when an older person is involved in a high-speed car accident, well, this thing just multiplies. This is a highly dangerous and a highly significant event for an older person.
Jim, we're going to move you onto the hospital bed, OK?
No
problems. One, two, three.
And we're ready for the story.
He was unconscious, he was trapped in the car, and the local fire brigade had removed him.
Yeah. About undersized here.
Yeah, a little bit.
His blood pressure is 108 on 70, no allergies, he's a lifetime smoker.
It took emergency services an hour to free Jim from his wrecked ute.
Across the front of his chest, he's really quite tender, particularly left more than right.
OK.
In his frontal pelvis area, very tender as well.
How are you going there, sir? My name's Jonathan. I'm one of the emergency doctors. How are you feeling?
Good.
Did you... look, the ambulance said you were sore in your left chest and you're sore in your pelvis.
When you break your pelvis, you can bleed from the veins and the arteries in the pelvis. The mortality, if you like, from broken pelvis goes up every hour that the pelvis hasn't been treated fully. So it's one of the injuries that we're probably the most afraid of in emergency medicine.
I don't even know what happened.
No, that's all right.
I got out of the house.
Where? Where were you going? Where would you have been going?
I was going to get food for my dog and everything.
Oh, yeah, going shopping.
I don't remember anything.
No.
Often when older people are in car accidents, they don't remember everything that happened. Is that concussion or is it because he's got a nasty brain injury? I'm hoping this is just concussion, but you never really know until you get a scan.
Yep. The lungs are okay?
Yeah.
Yes, so normal lung slide and there's negative fast, yeah?
Yes.
Yeah.
The ultrasound shows Jim doesn't have fluid in his lungs or any major internal bleeding.
So you're coming to do x-rays?
Yep.
Jim lives alone with his dog, Teddy. His daughter and son are on their way in to be with him.
Dad's never had an accident in the car. He's a pretty good driver. He drives that road quite often, going to the shops. He rescued Teddy from the RSPCA. They've been inseparable ever since.
I think the priority is the pelvis. If we can do the pelvis first, please.
Yeah.
X-ray. Maybe he's broken his hip. Just put the buckle right over the bits that are important.
On his x-ray, I just wonder whether he has cracked one of the pubic rami, one of the strut bones off to the side. We put pelvic binders on people to hold their pelvis together. The only trouble is when you put it on and you x-ray it, all you see is the buckle. And the buckle usually just happens to sit right over the area that's fractured.
X-ray, trauma two.
As Dr. Jonathan checks the chest x-ray, he sees something ominous.
No, I think that's a primary lung problem. That's a primary lung cancer. He's a lifelong smoker.
Whenever we see a tumour in someone, that's always serious. James is a smoker. He's got a mass in his lung. Smokers get lung cancer. I'm not sure whether James knows about this. It might be that we've just discovered something that he hasn't known about.
Always positive and negatives. If he never had the car crash, he never would have known and we wouldn't be able to treat the problem. We do find things like this when we look at people, so that's life, isn't it?
June.
Growing boy.
What are you doing with all that bread?
Going upstairs.
To make it through a busy day in the ED, Dr. Sung Chung likes to adhere to a strict diet.
Peanut butter and jam.
Can't even be bothered toasting it.
I'll have it for breakfast and lunch. This will be a usual dinner for me as well. I never get sick of apricot jam and peanut butter because there's always an alternative for strawberry jam with the peanut butter.
Roll up and go ahead.
I have a patient, 66-year-old female. She was traveling along a stretch of 100K zone when she's impacted with an embankment. Injury pattern, finger avulsion, just pain on her right ankle. BP, her last one was 83 over 37.
Dr. Chung's peanut butter and jam sandwich will have to wait.
Rachel speaking.
As he gets news of his next patient.
Sounds like she was involved in a very high-speed accident. She's complaining of chest pains and pain in the hand, pain in the foot.
Blood pressure of 80 and falling. 100K car crash.
Oh, gosh.
The team prepare the trauma bay for all possible injuries.
Oh, she's here.
Paramedics arrive with 66-year-old Rosalind, a mother of three, who failed to see a T-intersection and crashed into an embankment.
Hello there. I'm Sarah, one of the nurses.
Hi.
She was driving to help her son, Michael, who'd got a puncture on the bicycle he was riding.
We're going to do everything for you, OK, Rosalind? You're very safe.
Oh,
not yet,
can
done.
I just move my finger?
Yep. You ready? On three. One, two, three. Good job.
Emergency nurse Sarah Thomas wants to make sure Rosalind is as comfortable as possible.
There's going to be people coming at you from all different angles, OK?
Yeah, I just get a cramp in my back, sorry.
In your back? Whereabouts?
Oh, I think it's just my upright.
Now, my love, we're just going to get all of these stuff off you, OK, and get you connected to our monitor. Is that OK?
Yeah. I've had lymph nodes taken out of that arm, so nothing in that arm.
Yeah, that's right. Nothing on this arm. When Rosalind tells me that she's had lymph nodes removed from her arm, my mind jumps to the fact that she's probably had breast cancer or some kind of metastatic cancer recently. It's incredibly frightening when people have something that happens that brings them to us. It's probably one of the worst days of their life.
Can I have brought you Rosalind? She was travelling on a stretch of road approximately 100 k's an hour. She's careened into a dirt mound embankment. Airbags have deployed, and she's self-extricated out of the vehicle. She's degloved her right middle finger and painful on the right ankle.
Emergency registrar Andrew Wallace quickly steps in to ultrasound, looking for any internal bleeding.
What's that? What's
on? Chest.
Sorry, that was on there.
That's just the ultrasound probe pushing down on your chest. Is that what's hurting?
Yeah.
Where were you driving to?
I was going to pick my son up because he was riding his push bike and got a flat tyre.
Yeah. How old is he?
In his 40s.
Okay. Good old mum will come and get me, even when I'm 40.
Mum is really very stoked. She always puts herself last a lot of the time, making sure everybody's else is looked after first.
It's been a tough couple of years for Roslyn. She lost her beloved husband, Ross, to cancer and survived a battle with the disease herself.
Mum was diagnosed with breast cancer just after Dad had been diagnosed. She hid from Dad that she'd found her lump, and then Mum finally finished her treatment, and that's when Dad got worse. Unfortunately, he didn't make it. We looked after him till the end.
EFAST is negative, no pneumothorax.
The ultrasound confirms that Roslyn doesn't have a punctured lung or internal bleeding, but her finger is a concern.
Where are we bleeding from?
Roslyn's finger is in a bad way. My main concern is that the injury is very serious and we may have no option, or the plastic surgeons may have no option but to amputate the tip of the finger.
No, I think that's a primary lung problem.
72-year-old Jim rolled his ute several times after coming off the road at speed.
I'm worried that that's going to turn out to be something nasty, actually.
While looking for injuries, Dr. Jonathan has spotted something concerning on his chest X-ray.
That's a primary lung cancer. He's a lifelong smoker.
It's no real surprise that an older person who's been a smoker should develop a lung mass. I need to have enough information at hand before I deliver the news to James. So really have to be careful that I give him accurate information at the right time.
You feel more on this left side?
Just a little bit, yeah.
Dr. Jonathan carefully continues his examination, suspecting Jim has multiple fractures.
We're just having another look at you, sir. Are you sore in here? Are you sore in your hip?
Could be a little.
I think I can see a fracture in there, in your pelvis. So we're going to get a scan of that. Just one other thing. Are you sore? Do your ribs hurt?
Not a lot.
What about this? Does that hurt?
A little bit there.
Yeah. So you might have broken your breastbone even.
It's really important that we get James to CT so we can work out exactly which bones are broken and which organs are damaged. I'm suspicious he has a broken breastbone, a broken sternum, but he may have other injuries, other fractures, lung injuries and lung bruises, and they may be more significant.
Why don't we just try and get to CT? Because that'll give us the information we need.
Dr. Jonathan has grave concerns for Jim. After such a high-impact crash, he could have serious injuries and also a cancerous growth on his lungs. Dr. Jonathan anxiously waits to see what the scans reveal.
Let's see if I can get the images.
Breathe away.
66-year-old Roslyn is having an X-ray to look for fractures after she crashed her car into an embankment on a country road.
Is there anything on it?
So there might be a fracture on the left side of the pelvis.
There's a lot of problems with a fractured pelvis, particularly for somebody of Roslyn's age. It's extremely dangerous.
just going to get one x-ray of your ankle while you're there, okay?
X-ray.
My ankle feels like I've been away.
Is it broken?
Doesn't look like it. Yeah.
Rosalind's ankle x-ray doesn't show very much. Everything looks okay, but given the amount of pain that she's in, I strongly suspect there may be something broken inside.
We're going to take you to the CT scanner and get some pictures.
Yeah.
Don't forget to smile. I'm kidding, it doesn't take a photo of you smiling. There we go, I got a little laugh.
Are we ready to go?
Yep.
Excuse us.
We need to do a CT scan pretty quickly to check for any kind of injuries that we might be missing and to check the extent of any injuries that we have picked up. Back on three. One, two, three.
Yeah.
Just watching her. Blood pressure's dropping a little bit. The danger when Rosalind's blood pressure drops and us being in a CT scanner is that I don't have any of the equipment that I need in case she has a cardiac arrest or she bleeds out.
With Rosalind's blood pressure unstable.
I'm watching her like a hawk. It would be really difficult to treat her if this becomes an emergency situation, but this is what we do, this is what we're trained for. We do very extraordinary things with very limited means sometimes, but obviously our preference would be that we're in an environment that is a bit more controllable.
Well done, thanks.
Thanks, guys.
Nurse Sarah wants to get Rosalind back to the trauma bay as quickly as possible.
Hey.
Her son, Michael, is waiting to talk to his mum.
Have a chat to him.
Yeah, hi, Michael. And I'm all right. They're doing all the tests and they're looking after me well, and I don't want you worrying about what happened, okay?
Family means everything to Rosalind.
Yeah, good. Yeah, love you too. Bye. When their father was dying, it was during COVID, and of course, if he'd gone to hospital, we wouldn't have been able to see him. So the kids all moved home and they helped look after their dad.
Aww. That time is very precious, yeah.
Dr. Chung now has all the information he needs.
Rosalind's CT of her pelvis is good. There's no evidence of a fracture, which is great news. She's got a broken breastplate. With her broken sternum, unfortunately, she will be in pain, possibly for 6 to 12 weeks before it heals up completely. The CT scan of her ankle, unfortunately, show quite a few injuries. There are 3 different breaks in the bones to the ankle. She's going to need surgery on the ankle, probably pins.
And there's more bad news.
The x-ray of her finger confirms my worst fear. The x-ray shows complete destruction of the end of her finger. The tip of the third finger is completely smashed. It's completely smashed. There is no bone left, so it's all in pieces. I'm going to refer her to the plastic surgeons, but my biggest fear is that they're going to have to amputate the tip of a finger.
Rosalind has a long recovery ahead.
Given that she was traveling at that speed, although these injuries are significant, they could be a whole lot worse. So she's extremely lucky.
Michael's going to bring you some clothes in.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Probably won't sleep for a while because I'll lay awake and thinking, how did I let that happen? I consider myself a safe driver. And obviously I messed up.
See if I can get the images.
Dr. Jonathan is waiting to assess the scan results of 72-year-old Jim, who was driving in a 100K zone when his car left the road and rolled several times.
Oh, yes. The images just dropping into the pelvis. There's the buckle with the spring. Is that broken? That's what I'm worried about. I hope it's not. I think it's okay. I think he's got arthritis, but I don't think it's broken.
It looks like James's pelvis is actually okay. I've got the buckle out of the way, we can see behind the buckle, and I'm not seeing that fracture I thought I could see. So that's a relief.
I wonder if they found your dog.
Oh, do you have a dog in the car?
When the accident happened, Jim was on his way to buy food for his best friend, Teddy.
The little bike. He likes to stay in. I go shopping, bring him back food. And he's such a lovely dog. He'll just sit with you all day. I love him.
Dr. Jonathan continues to search for other injuries.
I'm worried about all these terrible injuries. Oh. His back, his vertebrae, look. Right there in a bit of trouble.
Just having a look at his back, it looks like an unstable fracture in his spine.
Let's have a look at his lungs.
Dr. Jonathan's main concern now is the potentially life-threatening cancer on James's lung.
It looks like a tumour to me.
It's really likely this is a cancer. Smoking gives you lung cancer.
He's had a cerebral downstairs collision. We don't have any obvious injuries, however, he's got thick spine tenderness and severe cerebral agitation.
Emergency registrar Dr. Andrew Wallace is stepping up to be team leader.
Okay, are you guys happy?
Yeah.
Team leader is the conductor of the trauma bay. You've got to keep everyone focused, and the first things we've got to do is set in motion identifying and fixing any major life-threatening injuries.
Paramedics have arrived with 38-year-old Chef Jared, who was found at the foot of an escalator in a shopping centre.
How are you doing, sir?
Not dying.
Probably not.
With potentially serious injuries, emergency doctor Emma West arrives to help.
Oh, what's happened?
Apparently found out some escalators.
So on go. Ready, set, go. And back on go.
My unwitnessed fall down a flight of escalators, approximately 3 metres.
Okay.
He doesn't have any hematomas, but he's got pain to his C-spine and back.
Okay.
I'm quite confused.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay,
what would you like me to do?
Oh, primary survey.
Yep. Dr. Andrew is team leader. That means he will be in charge of coordinating the team. I'm there to support him. It's his chance to step up.
Hello. How are you? I'm Emma.
Go for it. Do what you do. He's hit his head. He's in pain. He's not really sure what's going on. And he's really reaching out for some support. And he's grabbing my arm. He's grabbing my hand.
Lay back down, mate, because you're going to hurt your neck.
Oh, I feel good now.
Do you feel dizzy?
Yeah.
I'm here. Do you know what day it is, Jared?
Thursday.
It's not Thursday. It's Friday.
What?
It's Friday.
It's Thursday. Really?
Yeah.
I can see that he's not quite in his right state of mind. He's concerned about neck pain, and we're not exactly sure how far he's fallen, whether he's tumbled down the escalators or he's fallen off the side of them.
How far did you fall?
I don't know.
What happened to your foot?
I broke it at work.
Did you? Can you look at me? Good.
I don't feel good.
Equal air entry?
Yeah. Just try not to move your neck, mate.
I feel good.
Don't feel good. Are you going to vomit? No. We're just going to do a quick ultrasound of your belly.
Hit my head.
Did you?
Yeah.
Where did you hit your head?
They said they were bleeding from the back.
I'm just going to stay here and keep his head still.
My total focus now is keeping Jared's neck still. If he's got a broken neck, he's in a lot of trouble.
Get a good view.
Yeah? You can hear me behind you, can't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. The main thing is you have to keep your neck still, right? You've had a big fall.
Please, please.
Don't be scared. We'll look after you.
Yes.
Looks like a tumour to me.
Dr. Jonathan thinks he's seen a tumour on the lung of 72-year-old Jim as he treats him following a major car accident.
We just cut to the chase here.
A detailed report from radiology confirms that James also has other potentially life-changing injuries.
Oh. Oh. He's got fractures in his neck and he's fractures in his back.
This is really nasty.
There's something else wrong further up, I think.
The L1 fracture's sort of midway down your back, and it's a burst fracture.
So the body of that vertebra, one of the structural supports, has actually given way and burst and blown out. So that won't be able to hold up the rest of his spine. He's probably going to need an operation to hold his spine together.
Ah, he's got a broken sternum. There's supposed to be a joint here, and there's a joint here, but there's not supposed to be a joint there. He's got an extra joint equals fracture.
There's a lot of bad news I'm going to have to give this poor man right now. It's really awful to have to give people this sort of news. It's part of the job no one likes doing.
How are you feeling there?
All right.
All right? You've got some fractures in your spine. You've got a broken neck and you've got a broken back. So we're going to put you in a special collar that's a bit firmer to hold your neck still. And you've broken your breastbone too. And the other thing is, I can see a shadow in your lung up the top, and I'm worried it might even be a tumour. So that's something else we need to look into while you're here, OK? Yeah. So I know that's a lot to digest, but there's a shadow on the lung, broken neck, broken back.
Looking at James's fractures, he's got a long road ahead of him for the bones to heal. You're probably in an operation, then you'll need some rest time after that, some rehabilitation time. So we're looking at months to get things going again for James.
Once we know what the orthopaedic doctors want to do, then we'll be able to give you an update, all right? I'll come back and we'll talk later.
I'm just going to stay here and keep his head still.
38-year-old Jared's disorientated and frightened.
Really scared.
Don't be scared, we'll look after you.
After falling 3 metres from an escalator.
Unwitnessed, but when people have attended, he's potentially had episode of loss of consciousness. Definitely no concerns about seizures.
So he's fallen 3 metres.
He's hit max 3 metres okay. Down the escalators. He's been on crutches with the cam boot as well.
Jared, he's really very frightened and not very organised in his thinking at the moment, which might be the head injury.
He's complaining of C-spine and thoracic spine pain.
Yeah.
No definite head injury, but suspected. I suppose he would qualify as a trauma alert.
He is a trauma alert. Yeah, he should have a trauma alert.
Trauma alert, because he's 3 metres. So I think plan should be, if we'll continue primary surgery, we'll do our fast and wait for a CT.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to roll you on your side in a minute. Not yet. And we'll have Ophelia back, but then we're going to do a scan.
Just
doing
his EGM. Just relax, sir.
Are you sore? Yeah. Where are you sore?
My neck.
Don't move your neck. Who do you live with at home?
Girlfriend.
Okay.
Jared's terrified, and his partner is away and can't be with him, so he depends on Dr. Emma for support.
Yeah. Go away.
I'm just helping you remember not to move your neck, okay? So you just have to stay nice and still, okay?
I'm going to ask you to breathe in and hold your breath as well if you can, okay? I'll tell you when.
Stay still. Don't move.
He's scared, he's surrounded by people he's never met before, and he's really, you know, just feeling alone despite all the people in the room.
I've got your hand. Don't move your neck. Remember me? Nice and still. Look at the ceiling.
Okay, that's 2.5.
Yeah, I know. 2.25 marks of fentanyl. Yeah, great. Pop your hand down.
Ready for x-ray.
Suddenly, there's a problem.
You awake there? Jared?
Another x-ray.
Jared?
While I'm standing with Jared, he is losing consciousness and at the same time, he's stopping breathing. It's very, very concerning.
Jared? Jared?
Nurse practitioner Crystal Maloney has brought her dog Otto into the ED offices as part of a de-stress program for emergency staff.
This is my 4-year-old Bernese Mountain Dog. Otto is a very popular colleague. He gets lots and lots of love when he comes. Such a joy to see. He's so happy that then they can't help you feel happy as well.
What a little beautiful boy.
He's the most gorgeous animal that I have ever seen. Size, I just want to ride into battle.
And I think they can help alleviate a lot of stress that you might be feeling. I think he loves it.
He just loves it.
Leaving Otto with his newfound friends, Nurse Crystal has her next patient waiting for her.
Hi, Tulay. I'm Crystal.
Hi, Crystal.
I'm one of the nurse practitioners.
Tulay, a 44-year-old mother of two, has come in with severe chest pain and breathing difficulties.
Can you tell me in your words?
I've been having short of breath after midnight.
After midnight, okay.
Yeah, it started from after midnight and my chest pains were starting to get worse.
Mm-hmm.
Because I was getting chest pains and hot and cold flushes.
Mm-hmm.
And then the ambulance came and then they put a mask on me with air.
Yeah.
And then they eased it a bit.
Yeah, good.
But I've still got my pain. I've still got chest pain in there.
Do you mind if I have a listen? Tulay was woken up feeling that she couldn't breathe and feeling very short of breath. It can be very, very frightening if you can't breathe.
That's it. Good. I've got a chronic asthma.
And what do you take for your
Ventolin.
Ventolin. Now, do you smoke?
Yes.
Asthma can be life-threatening if someone's having an acute event and they can't get the help that they need when they need it. It can be very, very serious.
Even though she has a history of asthma, Nurse Crystal needs to investigate further.
Whenever someone comes to me that says they have chest pains, you immediately think of their heart, but then there is a lot of structures within inside the chest that can cause chest pain. But I need for you to have your chest x-ray. So someone will come and collect you for that, take you around for x-ray, bring you back. But we can still treat you with your Ventolin and your spacer in between. Okay? All right, I'll be back soon.
Thank you.
We know that she has asthma, and we also know that she is a smoker. If she has any illnesses, like a viral illness, like a cold or something like that, that can exacerbate her asthma and make it harder for her to breathe. We'll do a chest x-ray to see whether it looks like she has a chest infection, to see whether her heart is involved, and we can do an ECG as well.
Take a big breath in and hold. Just breathe normally, all done.
We need to work out where that chest pain might be coming from. And this is not a cardiac event, like a heart attack. Get you to do is wiggle your bottom back so you're sitting up nice and tall, because that'll help with your breathing.
Asthma sufferer Tulay has come into emergency with chest pain and shortness of breath.
Yep. And how much do you smoke a day?
Nurse practitioner Crystal has scanned her for possible heart or lung problems.
And have you been unwell recently?
Yes, I have been. I've just lost my father not long ago.
Okay.
And he's had some lung problems as well.
Yeah, that's a stressful event.
Yeah.
In Tulay's grief, there is an element of anxiety that can make her feel short of breath, and she can have symptoms of shortness of breath. I'll let you pour what you like in that, and I'll come back with that water for your mouth. Thinking about someone who passed away from a similar medical illness, and maybe they're headed down the same path, and that could be quite distressing.
My dad had lung problems, and he just passed away 2 months ago. He had a bit of a lung issue. So, I hope it doesn't come to me. We weren't expecting it so soon. He was 79 years old. So I was there when he passed away. And then I lost him.
Nurse Crystal reviews Tulay's x-rays, looking for heart or lung problems.
This is her heart, the border of her heart here, which is as expected, and these are the lungs. It looks pretty good. It's good news for Tulay that now that we can just concentrate on her asthma. I'm going to send her home, but I'm going to teach her how to use the spacer and how to use Ventolin properly, so that when she's at home and if she has episodes of shortness of breath, she's able to manage herself in a better way. I'm gonna go and get a spacer. Spacers, yes. But I wanna see how you go now with you trying it. That's it, keep the seal and then press, that's it, and just do your four breaths. Keep your lips closed around.
Good. Well done. You did it. Good job. Good job.
Thank you.
That's okay.
The next step is to stop smoking. Her giving up smoking is hard because of the stress of her father passing, but as long as she keeps smoking, she's putting herself at higher risk of a significant asthmatic event.
Tule's husband is at home with their children, waiting for news.
I'm better. Can you please come and pick me up?
I really love my job. You know, people come to hospital in all sorts of distress or injury or sickness.
Thank you.
That's okay.
And we can make a real difference.
Yep.
So just out that way and turn right around the corner.
Okay, good luck.
Improved them to the point that they can go home, that they're safe to go home. And home's a much better place than hospital.
I've got your hand. Don't move your neck. Nice and still. Look at the ceiling.
Dr. Emma is trying to calm 39-year-old Jared, who needs an X-ray.
Pop your hand down.
I'm ready for X-ray.
But he's drifting in and out of consciousness.
You awake there, Jared?
X-ray.
Jared? Jared? Jared?
Concerned, Dr. Jonathan arrives to assist.
Jared?
X-ray.
Jared?
Do you want to just wax him up? Oh, no.
You're all right, mate. You're okay.
It's all
right,
mate.
You're okay, mate. You're okay.
Jared, it's Emma. Hello. You have to stay nice and still, mate.
Jared is requiring all of my support to just stay still. And at the same time, he's having unusual periods where he's stopping breathing and dropping his conscious state. He's behaving like he has a severe head injury.
I'm so sorry.
Is he having a seizure? Is he going to return consciousness? Or is this something that really needs to get immediately to CT because he has a brain injury?
Now we're just going to take another X-ray, so stay nice and still.
Yeah, I have faint.
X-ray. Done.
Jared? 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 Now, give me the oxygen now, because his sat's at 86. Maybe we should just tube him.
Jared is looking more and more like he needs to be intubated so that we can keep him still and safely be able to manage him in the CT scanner where he doesn't have a doctor with him.
Are you OK with that, Andrew? Yeah. He's not breathing. He's not attending to me. He doesn't wake up and he quickly desaturates. Well, yeah, there you go. So he's doing that. I think we'll just tube him.
And here comes the ketamine.
Jared needs sedating quickly so they can put a breathing tube in.
Are you almost ready?
Yeah, good.
How are we looking position-wise?
Yep, felt that.
Is it wheezy at all?
It's pretty quiet. It's pretty quiet. Is he tight to ventilate?
Yeah.
Jared's in trouble. The tube is in position, but he's not breathing. ...39-year-old chef Jared has stopped breathing after he fell from an escalator and hit his head.
How are we looking position-wise?
Yep, felt that.
Dr. Emma has inserted an oxygen tube, but his lungs don't seem to be working.
It's very quiet. It's very quiet.
He's got no rash, anaphylaxis. Let's run a blood pressure. Oh, that's a bit better.
At last, it's shallow, but there is some breath.
That's better. Yeah. I've got air entry.
Can you go on the other one?
Yeah.
Dr. Jonathan strains to hear if both lungs are working.
I just want to make sure I'm not down the right main.
Here on that side.
Good.
Could be clear entry. It's almost like he had a plug of something and it was blocked.
Now that we've intubated Jared, his airway is protected and it doesn't matter if he's unconscious. The sole focus now is identifying a possible head injury. So as a team, we need to move him immediately to CT to see if there's an underlying brain injury.
The heart rate and blood pressure are fine.
A simple ride on an escalator could change Jared's life forever.
Was that something in
the hospital? It's on the same area, isn't it?
Yeah. Hopefully it's normal.
Hopefully it's old.
Nothing's jumping out.
No.
I'm relieved to see the initial scans look like there's no major head injury.
To make sure the scans are clear, Dr. Emma and Dr. Andrew take a closer look.
I'm just going through his C-spine just now, just to have a look.
Is it anything? Hopefully not. So far, scans look good.
The CT scan's reassuring, but it doesn't completely rule out major head injuries. Gerard could still have sustained a severe concussion. The major test will be when he's up in ICU and he's weaned off a sedation to make sure that he's still moving, talking, as you normally would expect him to be.
Gerard leaves the ED and is taken to intensive care for monitoring.
Two,
72-year-old Jim was choppered into emergency when he rolled his ute several times after coming off the road at speed.
Why don't we just try and get the CT? Because that'll give us the information we need.
The CT scan revealed the retired structural draftsman had major injuries to his back and neck and a tumour on his lungs.
After the surgery, they had also found some lung cancer that he wasn't aware of in some of the scans that they had done. We got told that he would probably need a lot of rehab. He'd be in hospital for quite a while. Towards the last week, he got an infection and he just wasn't responding to any antibiotics and just deteriorated, just stopped responding. And yeah, so he passed. I'd love Dad to be remembered for his kind heart, his generosity, and yeah, always tried to make you feel special.
Thanks, Ray.
39-year-old chef Gerard was rushed into emergency after falling from an escalator in a shopping centre.
Gerard!
Emergency doctors feared he had a brain injury when he repeatedly lost consciousness.
Was that something?
It's on the same area, isn't it?
Yeah.
After multiple scans were clear, Gerard spent a night in intensive care before being allowed to go home. Mother of two and asthma sufferer Tule came into emergency with severe chest pain and breathing difficulties.
I've been having short of breath after midnight.
Tule lost her father to lung disease.
We weren't expecting it so soon. He was 79 years old.
After x-rays and blood tests were clear...
It looks pretty good.
Nurse practitioner Crystal showed Tule how to better manage her asthma, and she was able to go home.
Bye. There's going to be people coming at you from all different angles, OK? Yeah.
66-year-old Rosalind was driving to help her son Michael when she went through a T-intersection, crashing down an embankment.
What's
CT scans revealed multiple fractures, and Dr. Chung was concerned her finger would need to be amputated.
The tip of the third finger is completely smashed. There is no bone left.
Look at you and Dad when you were young.
Memories. Mm. When I look back at the accident, I count my lucky stars that I'm still breathing, but more that it was only me hurt.
Rosalind spent 13 days in hospital after successful surgery to fix her broken ankle. And miraculously, plastic surgeons were able to save her finger.
I was really pleased with how my finger is. I can't see where he stitched, so I think he did a pretty good job.
That's you, Carly.
Mm. It's a baby. Yeah, it's a long time ago. My recovery's going good. I can walk around. When I go out, I take my walker only because I don't want to have any falls or anything. I'm looking forward to be able to drive again. If Michael calls me again to say that he's got a flat tyre on his push bike, that will mean that I am driving again, and I'll be very happy to be able to do that.